Okay, so I hope everybody was at dinner last night and heard our conversation between David Crane and Andy Karsner. And I'm not sure if it was right before or after David called Andy an ignorant slut, but I think he said something like 98% of his business is from the grid, but he's betting big on distributed power generation. This is a big idea in the world of energy generation. And it's something that's really building up steam. And I mean, think about it, wouldn't it be better, it sounds better, that instead of having, you know, these big installations, we'd have power generated from everywhere. We'd have small solar generation, we'd have fuel cells, we wouldn't be as dependent on one part of the grid being knocked out. But, you know, the reality of it is that distributed generation poses big challenges and will disrupt the way we produce and regulate and consume energy. So here to talk about that, I have my panelist. And right here on my right, this is Ted Craver, who's the president and CEO of Edison International, which is the parent company of Southern California Edison, and also Edison Mission Group, a power generation business. And he's also a trustee of the Nature Conservancy. On his right is Nat Kreamer, who's the CEO of Clean Power Finance. Was a co-founder of Sunrun, and also, interestingly, was awarded a Bronze Star for medal for his service in the Special Forces in Afghanistan. So we thank you for that service.
Thank you.
And Tom Werner, the president and CEO of SunPower, and engineer by training and with a long, interesting career in the business that led him to where he is now. I'm going to start with you, Ted. First, maybe you could just explain the two parts of the business that you run and the difference between them, between the utility and the power generation, and how you manage those two. Just quickly give us a picture of, you know, the business you're running and how you're interfacing with this changing power
sure.
structure.
Well, Southern California Edison is a large electric utility serving about 14 million population here in Southern California.
So you're responsible for the lights being on here?
One hopes.
Yeah, okay, good.
Unless they go off, in which case it's somebody else.
Yeah, got it. It's one of those distributed guys.
Yeah. Yeah, but in that business, really, we're focused on the wires side of the business, so transmission and distribution. So if you will, we're the ones who deliver the electricity to the homes and businesses. That's a huge business for us. That really represents annually about $3.5 billion worth of investment. We have a large electric grid that we manage and operate. The other part of our business is actually gone through quite a bit of transformation. So we have very much de-emphasized the generation side of our so-called unregulated business. And we now are focused almost exclusively on building out a platform to provide energy services to commercial and industrial customers nationwide. Some element of that someday we believe will also take us overseas.
Okay, great. So you're right at the center of this. I think California has more than a quarter of the distributed power generation that exists right now, and you're really dealing with this scenario that we're here to talk about day to day. So, I mean, I think everybody knows the power grid was built to move electricity from big power plants out to individual points and to do that efficiently, not to take in power from millions of different points and integrate it. So just like express the challenge that we're looking at. I mean, you know, why is it hard to do this? What is the scale of the challenge that we're looking at? And the other thing is our power grid was mostly built decades ago. It's really old. We probably need to replace it anyway, right?
Well, it's not static. It's always being refurbished and replenished. That's what a large part of that multi-billion dollar annual investment is about, is, you know, replacing poles and transformers, conductors, relays, so on. And that's an important part. What we're really looking at is the grid of the future. That's what we are in the process of building. So things like smart meters would be a component of the grid of the future. Being able to absorb distributed generation, being able to manage the intermittency of the various renewable resources, whether they're distributed or central plant, and doing all of that with a modern digital monitoring and control device laden system that allows you to very quickly shunt power back and forth in two-way flows as opposed to the simple one-way flows of yesterday. That's really what we're about, and that's our primary business, is building that grid that can handle those activities.
Is there a price tag on the grid of the future?
Well, again, it's a little difficult because sometimes what you're doing is you're taking a manually operated relay or a manually operated circuit breaker, and you are replacing that with a digital device that can be managed from our distribution operations center, or in many cases, it's actually done automatically. So it is just the change in flows that allow this to be managed automatically inside the system. So I view it as less about, you know, there's one big day where you throw out the old and come in with the new. It's just a constant evolutionary process of moving as quickly as possible to a smarter, more flexible, more resilient system.
Well, let me go to your solar brethren here. Nat, you do solar financing. Maybe you could just quickly explain your approach at Clean Power Finance and, you know, what's your model and what's your vision?
So we run a marketplace that has customers who participate in it who sell, install, and finance solar. There are 143,000 people who work in the U.S. solar industry now. That's more than the U.S. coal industry. I think that's good for the economy and the environment.
That's a great statistic.
It's a great statistic. 21,000 of them work with Clean Power Finance. So we are a business-to-business service provider. And what we're doing with folks who invest, and some of them are traditional utilities like Integrys, is we're helping them own generation assets that are sitting on customers' roofs. And so a company that sells and installs might come to you and say, I'll help you refinance your electricity bill, save money with solar. You'll feel good about that for two greens. The first green is that you save money. The second one is all the good things you do for the environment, national security, and the economy. And so that business has been growing really fast for us, and I think that's emblematic of the growth in the small-scale DG solar sector.
So the price of solar has been falling. Installation has been growing like 50% a year globally for a while. When is solar going to be affordable enough that there will not be subsidies involved, that it'll just be, you know, something that people are doing on a cost basis?
So I think that's a question, if you don't mind if I
jump in.
Sorry, Nat.
Take it.
So it's a question of where. It's already happened. You know, we're building a 70-megawatt facility in Chile that is no subsidies, and it's feeding, or the payment we get is merchant. So the idea, it's not theoretical, it exists today. It's being built as we speak.
How is that financed? I mean,
mind you, it's traditional project finance, so mainstream financing. Mind you, you do have high electricity and high sunshine, but you have that same thing in other places in the world. So depends on where you are, the answer is now. Now, if you've got more specific and you said California, or, you know, when could you get economic without the ITC, for example, that's a little harder. You know, that's 5 years, but it's not 15, it's not 20.
Mm-hmm. I mean, so you guys are talking about two different models, putting it, you know, individuals putting it on their roof maybe, and, you know, a giant installation with more traditional financing. I mean, so, and you're a little bit more, you know, what you're financing is a little bit more of this distributed, classically what we're thinking about, distributed. So you want to get the panels out there, but you're not so much worried about his problem of getting the power into the system, right?
We are, we aren't, right? So in some senses, we want that customer to be able to have on-site generation, and there's a strong value proposition to doing that. On the other hand, an enabler is having a grid that is healthy. If you think about it, there's a debate that goes on, I think, really between the solar industry and utilities today, which is to say, you know, who's paying for the grid and what's the cost of operating and using it? A couple of years ago, the debate was, are you going to just have utility scale power or are you going to have distributed power? And I think the answer is, it's sort of like mainframes versus PCs. And today you have both. You have apps that are out of the cloud operating on a very powerful PC that you use as a phone in your pocket. And so the challenge for, I think, for all of us is to make sure that we integrate really well to the grid so that we can have sustainable penetration rates. Nobody wants a tragedy of the commons on the grid.
And what's the key of making that integration happen smoothly?
Maybe I'll pick that one up,
because
I think that's kind of our role is ensuring that you do need good policies that allow for these things to interconnect. So whether you're talking about central station, the types of things that Tom and his company do, which we buy a lot of power from them, or whether it's distributed, where individual homes and businesses are putting these on their roofs, you need to make sure that these things interconnect well, meaning efficiently and safely. So that's a real key factor for us. A lot of that gets into the inverter technology that's being used for the distributed generation.
What is that?
The box that converts it from DC power okay. to AC power, which sure. is what the system uses, is alternating okay. current. So we really try to make sure that it's being done safely, it's being done reliably. There's a good set of mechanisms for bringing all of that different type of generation into the system, and that once it's in the system, it actually works and can be distributed to the users.
How big an issue is safety in all of this? I mean, is safety just something that you would say, well, you know, to scare people to be more responsible, or is it actually like something we should worry about as we stumble through this transition?
Unfortunately, it is a very big issue. Electricity, particularly alternating current, high voltage, that is deadly. So it's a big issue for us to maintain public safety. We spend a huge amount constantly educating the public on what to do when they're down power lines in a windstorm and that type of thing, because it can be deadly. It's also a very big issue for our workers. We have 15,000 people. Now, not all of them have their hands on the conductors, but we do have quite a few people that are directly in contact working on what they call hot wire. So the power hasn't been turned off when they're working on the distribution system. So safety is a big issue.
So backstage, you guys were remarking that you're Tom's biggest customer. Tom is, you know, his business is doing these larger installation type facilities. Explain, like, what's the landscape for that now, and how does that fit into this evolving grid model?
Yeah, we do.
Complementary to what, you know, for instance, Nat's working on.
Uh-huh. Yeah, and we do probably 60% is large power plants and 40% is DG. And Nat's company would finance a lot of those right. installations that our company would do. So I have a perspective of both. In the ground mount systems, of course, the compelling thing is you get scale, and so you can get electricity that is incredibly economic, at least vis-a-vis, say, 3 or 4 years ago. When you put it on a roof, you don't have the scale, so it's a bit more expensive, perhaps 2x. So you have a scale advantage, and you also have the advantage with PV that it's quick to build, quick to turn on, and easy to locate relative to other options. So you can turn the transmission problem on its head and say, where do I have transmission and load? And you can fit in a PV power plant. That's the good news. The challenge is that the RPS, is the Renewable Portfolio Standards for ground mount systems in America, are largely met today. So there's this large amount of these systems being built. And you go out 3 years and there's a bit of a valley. That's changing, though, because the costs have come down. And so I think there's utilities all over the country that are starting to say, I don't need an RPS. Maybe this makes sense on its own. So that's America, rest of world, really South America, China. China's massive, 14 gigawatts of solar a year, almost all ground mount. So a massive opportunity. So that's really the big places, America, China, South America, emerging, Mexico, Middle East someday. So it's very much an international business, very much a policy business today, but transitioning to being less incentive dependent, the ground mount business.
That's actually a really important point to maybe take off on. Recent study done in California, now, mind you, each state's going to have a little different cost structure and all this, but unsubsidized, so without any of the incentives, just kind of raw, if you will, the utility scale solar installations would be around $80 to $100 a megawatt. The rooftop solar on large commercial buildings, according to the study, was around $177 a megawatt. Rooftop solar on your typical residential home was around $222 a megawatt. So that gives you some idea on an unsubsidized basis how these things would array. Kind of a footnote, and this is where some of the tension comes in, I think, for other utilities outside of California. If you were to erect a new CCGT gas-fired power plant, kind of the most efficient one, that would be more in the $60 a megawatt. So all of these things are ultimately kind of competing with each other, but when you lay in the different subsidies that are provided at the federal level, state level, and things like net energy metering and so on, it kind of distorts those numbers, but those are the raw numbers according to this E3 study.
So I think in the distributed generation business, Ted's absolutely right that you see solar being in some instances more expensive, but in the distributed solar generation business, it ends up being about competing for the customer relationship. Yeah. So some folks on my team have a picture of me with a hard hat standing on a roof, and they put a caption on and stuck into my door that said, "Occupy the roof." And I think this is really a change that's happening, which is that you can go into a territory where there isn't deregulation and offer electricity choice. And that has really changed the market in a lot of ways. And so I think what you're seeing is distributed solar has done that. It's created a value chain now that will allow other distributed technologies, I would argue, to go out to market faster. And maybe I'll spark the conversation with a little bit of tension here. That next technology that I think would have fundamental business model implications would be storage, right? So if and when storage works, and I'm definitely not an expert on that, there is now an industry with some scale that can go put that in the hands of the customer. And now you have a situation where you have business model tension for traditional wires businesses.
How would that work for you, Ted? Distributed storage.
Yeah, again, I think the way we tend to view this is there is no single one-size-fits-all or one approach to any of this. This is a huge capital-intensive business, and one thing you learn early on in that context is you want to have a diversity of supply, you want to have a diversity of approaches, because you're really having to spend a long time to recover all of these investments. So storage, we think, actually can add a lot to the resiliency of the distribution system. In California, in fact, recently a mandate was made to install 1,325 megawatts of storage across the three investor-owned utilities in the state. So our chunk of that is around 600 megawatts, and we're busy now working on where we would place the storage capacity in our distribution system. Some of that will go into our substations, some of that will actually be at homes and businesses, some of that will be even further upstream in what we call the bulk power system. So we think it can actually help quite a bit in terms of managing those flows of electricity and the intermittency of some of the newer resources.
We're going to get to questions from the audience in a minute, but it strikes me that there's a tension here. Like there's a demand for the grid to be more flexible, more
definitely
supportive and reliable than ever, and yet relinquish control to power generation from all around. I mean, do you feel sorry for yourself about that, or
not in the least? No, really, not in the least. In fact, I think that's a bit of a misnomer. The more complex you make the system, which is what's happening when you're adding generation capacity out at the end of the system at the individual homes and businesses, the more you do things like storage, the more you introduce digital monitoring and control devices on the system, all of that makes the system more flexible, more resilient. It also makes it more complex to operate. So we see really the principal role of the utility is to build that next generation grid and to manage it with all of these new technologies being introduced. And frankly, it's a very exciting time.
I hate to use the G word, but what is the role of government in doing this? I mean, I doubt that any of you would like to see the government march in and just dictate the rules of how this is all gonna go, but where should they be playing a useful role? The utilities, power is sort of a basic security question, and a lot of regulatory.
So I think, first of all, as an overlay, I'd say what's exciting is you guys went out in the audience. You go from, I want to be a little careful here, Ted, but say 5 or 10 years ago where you get your power bill and you just pay it. You're a passive recipient, you just pay. 5 or 10 years from now, you're going to go from that to almost total control, or you're going to have a lot more say in things. So that's That's very compelling. That's very cool. Now, what I've learned, I've only got 11 years in energy, but getting an idea of how things work, there's incentives and there's policy. And energy will always be policy driven for the reasons that you say. Incentives is a different animal. And people like to cite the solar incentives, but if you dig into it, all energy has some form of incentive. So, you know, if we had 2 hours to sit up here, we could talk about, you know,
we could stack the congressional budget office rating, and you'd find out solar.
That sounds really interesting. We should do that.
that takes a little while. But
right after
so that's incentives, and we all get it that we want to get off incentives, and we want to be economic. And of course, solar industry is doing that, and other industries are as well. Ted's made some great points about the grid. The grid is going to be a fascinating place to be, and that's where his company is emphasizing things because, the idea that you're going to be off the grid is a hell of a long ways out. So you're going to need, and maybe never, I don't know, but you're going to need a smart grid. And so the challenge is that transition to, well, it's already happening, but how do you distribute the economics? That's going to be the challenge.
So you go from a cost, so we're excited to have Edison as an investor in us and our corporate equity, and we really like networks. Running a marketplace is really running a network as a value chain. And I look at the wires business and say, 10 years ago, people would say it's a cost-plus business model, and I've got this regulatory business. I think what's exciting, what Ted has said, is I've got this really valuable network. I'm going to make it more valuable. So one of the challenges, a regulatory barrier, is there are something like 3,100 different wires companies. I'm including small munis and lots of folks. But this is a high capex, low margin intensive business. Name for me any other industry where you have 3,100 participants in a 100-year-old industry. The answer is nowhere, and the only reason from my perspective that exists is because there's regulation at the municipal level that has created a Byzantine situation in terms of the industry. It doesn't actually let best operators who are really forward-thinking like Edison bring that to the rest of the country.
I want to give a chance for the audience to get involved. I think we have a question over here. Please identify yourself and
Sure. Naimish Patel from Gridco Systems. I wanted to continue the thread of conversation, particularly on the economics here. So, it seems to me that the sort of fundamental challenge for the wires operators is that although their revenue scales with volumetric sales, kilowatt hours, their in capital investments they need to make actually scale with the peak loads. And indeed, in some cases, particularly in Bavaria, for example, the peak loads now become dominated by the export, the PV export, rather than just the loads. And so in that model where revenues are scaling slower than the capital investments the wires operators need to make, is there a need as a result for a change in the revenue model for the wires operators to create a more sustainable financial model going forward?
Yeah, so maybe I'll jump in on that one.
How are you gonna get paid?
Great question. Maybe a couple of pieces that people may not know. In California and a few other states as well, we actually are in what they call a decoupled state. So it really, our revenues are not dependent on how many kilowatt hours we sell. So that's one piece. Now, most of the utilities in the country are still coupled, and so the revenues do go up and down with the actual number of kilowatt hour sales. Beyond that point, though, I think you raise a really good one, which is we believe the more you view the wires part of this business as a network, that the more you need to shift from what is still a volumetric charge, even though our revenues are insulated from that, the volumetric charge to something more akin to what the real cost structure is. So for us, our average bill is about $100 a month. About $30 to $35 of that is fixed cost. The rest is variable cost. So if you had a kind of perfect rate design would be a fixed charge of around $30 or so, and the rest would be volumetric, reflecting the variable nature of the costs. Some legislation was passed in California last year, signed by the governor, actually passed by supermajorities in the Assembly and Senate. That actually starts to introduce now a fixed charge. So over the next few years, a fixed charge of up to $10 can be established. and there are some other changes they're making to the volumetric part. So that's a step in the right direction, and we're seeing this happen in some other states as well. We're moving a little bit more towards a fixed charge that allows us to build that grid of the future and have a proper revenue model for recovering costs.
What's the right model for compensating people who are generating power and feeding it into the grid?
Well, of course, that gets right into the favorite subject that we all have, net energy metering. But, you know, fundamentally...
What's the Craver plan?
Actually, the Craver plan is that you have this fixed charge for some portion, because no matter whether you're generating some of your own electricity or not, you're using the grid. In fact, as I think I've tried to describe earlier, you're actually using the grid more, the distribution system more, if you have, say, a rooftop solar installation, because there's times when you're pulling power from that and there's times when you're feeding it back into the grid. You want to get paid for that excess power that you're feeding back into the grid. So that you're actually using the grid in a more dynamic way. So we think some level of fixed charge is appropriate. And then we believe that certainly the electricity that we would buy from solar generators, and as I indicated, we're really indifferent as to where we buy the bulk of our generation from. We would pay a generation cost portion of that as opposed to a full retail cost portion.
Couple of quick comments. One, this has been done before with energy efficiency, so there might be something to learn there. Two, Ted's the incoming chair of EEI. EEI is working with the solar industry through NRDC on exactly this, and it's you know, there's good work being done, but there's work that needs to be done. Because third, I would say there are advantages to DG of generating at the source. While it's not entirely coincident with the peak, it is certainly coincident with the peak. And being coincident with the peak is a nice thing, as the question suggested. So we need to, you know, as I think what Ted said is right on, of course. There are some nuances in that, that there's the right people working on it.
Yeah, I think it's a complicated trade, and the trick for the end consumer is how to keep it simple and make sure that the economics work for both, really both industries and value chains.
It's very important.
Yeah. You have to message to the consumer who invests in solar that they're getting compensated and they don't feel like, you know, they want to feel like they're getting something for their investment.
I defy people here to really talk to the average consumer about what is a kilowatt hour. They think about energy as going to the gas pump. And so when we start to get into the complicated, what is the trade? And that's where net metering has worked really well. And I think, you know, we have to look at how it performs over time. But it's worked really well in that it's simple. And at some scale, you'll start to look at it and say, is that the right trade?
And let's see if we should sneak in one more question. Do we have another question from the audience? Did I see one? Over here on the left.
Hi. There's been a lot of friendliness up here.
Just please identify yourself.
I'm Ann Mulkern. I'm a reporter with the E! News. There's been a lot of friendliness up here, but there's also been a lot of tension in the industry. In California, for example, Solar City has these 500 test homes with battery storage that, for the most part, the utilities have not let them connect to the grid. I may be oversimplifying that, so forgive me. And in Hawaii, we've got the utilities have basically stopped a lot of PV customers from connecting to the grid because they're saying they have so much solar that it poses a risk of too much power feeding back into the system. Yeah. So I just wanted to see if you guys can sort of address going forward this disruption that's happening, and there does seem to be a lot more tension than what I'm hearing up here.
So I'll make it quick, which is you have folks who are thinking about being on the offense and building really the utility of the future. You have other folks saying, it's not my problem. Maybe I'll be retired by the time it is in my territory. I've had actually a CEO of a large power company tell me that, so I didn't make it up. And the third one is, I don't like competition. And you can have a lot of arguments. They can be regulatory, they can be technical. But basically what it means is I didn't like PURPA. I didn't like deregulation, I don't like solar now, and I think you're seeing that play itself out in certain markets, but in more mature markets and markets where we're looking to have a really big solar industry and really build the utility of the future, like here in Southern California, you're hearing a different tone. And I think hopefully that gives you hope. It definitely gives me hope to really have two fantastic changes in the utility industry, one, and a fantastic opportunity for the solar industry in general.
And you picked a good place, Hawaii. Look at some of the PUC proceedings in Hawaii, and there's some suggestions of how things will evolve with storage and some of the things that Ted said actually earlier.
All right, well, it's always good to end with hope, and that's how we're going to have to end because we've run out of time, but join me in thanking my panelists.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Good stuff.
Good stuff.